Welcome everyone to another USGA Green Section webcast. My name is Brian Whitlark. I'm an agronomist in the West region of the USGA Green Section. Now today we get to discuss a topic that arguably is the most important and certainly the most frequent practice deployed on putting greens, which is mowing. And more specifically, we're going to discuss the impact that mower setup has on the surface quality of putting greens. Take a close look at this image, and what do you think of this surface? Well, it's pretty tight, isn't it? Well, this image was captured by Rodney Lingle, former superintendent at Memphis Country Club, and I'm sharing this image because this represents some of the finest turf surfaces, regardless of turf variety, that I have ever seen. And Rodney and his equipment management staff ensure that when the mowers leave the turf care facility, they are sharp and finely tuned every single time. So this is an example of the surfaces that are possible when equipment is maintained at a very high level. To get the ball rolling here, I'd like to give you an overview of what we will discuss in this webcast. And first of all, this is not a how-to guide to mower maintenance. Rather, the intent of this webcast is to inform you about how mower setup can be adjusted to improve your putting surfaces. So specifically, we will cover the following topics. First, we'll discuss a systematic approach to mowing. Next, we'll talk about sharp equipment. We'll talk about the height of cut and the effective height of cut. We'll talk about aggressive setup and what exactly that means with regard to the characteristics of the mower. We'll talk about a kind of a hot topic, the frequency of clip. We'll talk about scalping and how not to scalp. And then we'll end up with a discussion on double mowing and its impact on the quality of your putting surfaces. You need to have a plan. Now, I'm an Arizona Wildcat fan, but even I can recognize the genius of Nick Saban at Alabama. Now, Mr. Saban has a plan, and obviously that plan has been pretty darn successful over the past 5 years. So you need to have a plan with regard to mower setup and maintenance. Remember that nothing influences the quality of the greens as much as how it is mowed. Now stay connected with your equipment manager and mechanics. Meet with them on the greens to discuss the quality of cut, discuss top dressing, and ask for their suggestions and input. Finally, as a team, commit to the highest mowing standards. And this is important regardless of whether you are at a low or high budget facility. Now let's move on to a discussion on the importance of sharp equipment. Prior to each use, greens mowers must be able to cut 20-pound paper across the entire width of the reel and bed knife every time they leave the turf care facility. In a 2004 study at Michigan State University, researchers concluded that the proper maintenance of the mowing equipment can have just as significant, if not more, of an impact on green speed as lowering the mowing height. Prior to each use, ensure that the mower cuts 20-pound paper across the width of the reel. The importance of sharp reels and bed knives cannot be understated. To help maintain sharp equipment, it is suggested to grind relief on the reel blades. A small amount of relief, about 20 degrees, as shown in Figure A here, decreases the land area or the amount of metal making contact with turf leaves, with sand, other debris, and the bed knife. Now, you can use spin grinding throughout the year to maintain a sharp edge on the reels, but once the relief angle wears down substantially, it is time to grind relief back onto the reel blades. Relief angles are also important on the bed knife. The top angle, which is sometimes referred to as the ejection angle, should be between 3 to 6 degrees on greens mowers. Now it's larger on the fairway units because, well, the clippings are larger. So this angle is important in order to properly eject or throw the clippings into the basket. Otherwise, the clippings are left on the surface. Now the face angle is sometimes referred to as the presentation angle, and it should be between 11 to 15 degrees. And this angle is important to present or push the grass blades up for clipping by the real blades. Backlapping is a four-letter word in some areas. It is often perceived as an inferior practice, and it's really fallen out of favor in the southwestern U.S. where I travel. However, I would like to reinvigorate the use of backlapping as a means to maintain sharp equipment between grinding events. So backlapping removes less metal than grinding, and as such can maintain sharp equipment while extending the life of the reel blades and the bed knives. For green mowers, use backlapping compound of 220 grit and backlap frequently every day, but for only about 3 to 5 minutes. If after 5 minutes the reel and the bed knife are not sharp and won't cut paper, then more than likely it's time to grind. Sharp equipment improves turf health. Dull reel blades and bed knives will tear or shred the turf leaves, opening wounds that may increase disease or insect activity. Dull blades may also strip the chlorophyll from the leaf tip, as shown in the lower image on the right here. In an Iowa State study conducted by Nick Christians evaluating the impact of dull equipment on turf health, he found the following. Dull blades injured the turf such that it produced more ethylene, which is an indicator of stress, whereas the turf mown with sharp blades showed improved visual quality, contained greater chlorophyll concentration, had less uncut leaf blades, and fewer shredded leaf blades than the turf mown with the dull equipment. A close-up image as seen through a prism gauge shows putting green turf mown with dull equipment. Notice in this image many uncut leaf blades and subblades with brown tips that have been stripped of chlorophyll. Now let's look at an image captured on a green mown with perfectly sharp equipment. There are not many uncut leaf blades here, and the surface looks like a toothbrush. So which surface do you think the ball will roll smoother? Ernie Hernandez at Bel Air Country Club was nice enough to share this image with me of a Poa Annua leaf blade cut with a perfectly sharp mower. And obviously this is really exactly what we're looking for, and what you should strive for is a cleanly cut leaf blade with a nice sharp mower. And here is another image showing a finely cut leaf blade. We've discussed the impact that sharp equipment will have on the surface quality of the greens and the turf health. And now let's look at its impact on fuel use. So I'll pose a question for you here, and that is, what mower characteristic most influences fuel use? Is it the reel to bed knife clearance, or is it the sharpness of the reel and the bed knife? Representatives from Bernhard conducted a fuel study hosted at the Bridgewater College in England. So this study compared fuel use of four different mowers, two dull mowers that had not been ground for about 30 days, and two sharp mowers. So the first dull mower was set up with no reel to bed knife contact, defined as 0.002 inch clearance. The other dull mower was set up with light contact, and was defined as a whisper between the reel blades and the bed knife. So the study also used two sharp mowers that had been spun ground, and the first was set with no contact again, 2/1000ths of an inch clearance, and the other was set up with contact, defined as the whisper. So back to our question, which mower used the most fuel? Was it the light contact mowers or was it the dull mowers? Well, let's take a look and see. The fuel consumption is listed on the right column in this table. So take a look at the table, and now you can see that the dull mowers, contact or no contact, use double the fuel as the sharp mowers. And you could make an argument that the no contact, which remember was 2/1000ths of an inch clearance between the reel and the bed knives, used the least amount of fuel. But clearly, the mower sharpness has the biggest impact on fuel efficiency. Now let's shift gears a bit and discuss the height of cut and the effective height of cut. First, at today's low mowing heights, the mowing height setting must be accurate with a tolerance of only 1/1000ths of an inch from one side of the reel to the other. The effective height of cut, which is the actual height of cut of the turf blades on the greens, is not the same as the bench setting. The effective height of cut is measured with a prism gauge in the field, and on the bottom right here, here's my buddy Josh Cook, who is the superintendent at Oak Tree National in Edmond, Oklahoma, measuring the effective height of cut during the USGA Senior Open Championship in 2014. So the prism gauge, it's a good tool to measure the effective height of cut and the quality of cut on the greens, which can be measured by quantifying the number of uncut leaf blades. But keep in mind that this tool is subjective and the effective height of cut value will vary depending on the user. As an example, during the Senior Open at Oak Tree National, the bench setting on the mowers was 0.150 inches with the John Deere 220C mowers outfitted with the low-cut bed knife. But the effective height of cut, as seen here with the prism gauge, was about 80/1000ths of an inch. So the effective height of cut is significantly lower than the bench setting in this case, which really is not uncommon. The more aggressive the mower, the lower the effective height of cut will be in relation to the bench setting. Furthermore, greens during this championship were mown 3 or even 4 times per day in some cases. When you increase mowing frequency, it will lower the effective height of cut. And we observed this same phenomenon during the 2015 Senior Open at Del Paso Country Club in Sacramento, California. During this championship, during the advance week, we were mowing with Toro 1000 mowers set at 0.125 inches for bench setting. Well, the effective height of cut was about 0.100. But after several days of double mowing and rolling, the effective height of cut was lowered to about 80/1000ths of an inch without changing the bench setting of the mowers. Fixed versus floating head mowers also impact the effective height of cut. Oftentimes, floating head mowers effectively mow 20/1000ths to 40/1000ths higher than a fixed head machine set up with the same reel and bed knife. Also, the aggressiveness of the mower has a big impact on the effective height of cut. For example, a Tower mower outfitted with a black bed bar or bed shoe should be set from 15/1000ths to 25/1000ths of an inch higher than the same mower outfitted with the less aggressive red bed bar. Here is an image comparing the red and the black bed bar on the Toro machines. You know, other than the color, they look pretty darn similar, but let's take a closer look at what makes the black bed bar more aggressive. A diagram provided by Tom Langworthy from the Toro Company illustrates the red bed bar with an angle of 6.2 degrees of the bed knife and a BCD, or behind center distance, of 0.164 inches. Now remember that as the angle of that bed knife increases, so does the mower aggressiveness. And furthermore, as the behind center distance increases, or in other words, the distance from the cutting point of the bed knife to the center point of the reel increases, the more aggressive the mower will be. Now let's look at the black bed bar. In this illustration showing the black bed bar, notice the bed knife angle has increased from 6.2 to 9 degrees, and the BCD, or behind center distance, has increased from 0.164 up to 0.279 inches, which increases the aggressiveness of this mower and will effectively cut lower than the less aggressive setting. To better illustrate the impact of changing to a more aggressive setting, we conducted a small trial just last week in Southern California on a bentgrass putting green. We used one Toro Greensmaster eFlex 2100 model and mowed five passes using the backtrack method, with each setting aggressive or non-aggressive. The five passes with the red bed bar yielded 6.1 ounces of clippings, and the five passes with the more aggressive black bed bar harvested 8.9 ounces of clippings, an increase in clipping yield of 46% over the less aggressive red bed bar. Here are some images captured during the trial. The mowing height was 0.110 inches in this study and remained unchanged with the red and the black bed bar. We were not able to see any discernible difference through the prism gauge, but clearly the difference in clipping yield was impressive. And this was just one mowing event. The impact over several weeks, several months, and years is where you will see a difference in the surface quality of the putting greens. The reel diameter also influences the effective height of cut. For example, a new reel will cut about 20 thousandths of an inch lower than a worn reel. And why is that? Because as the reel wears, the bed knife must be adjusted up to meet the smaller diameter reel, which effectively reduces the angle of the bed knife. For example, on a Jacobson unit, the bed knife angle decreases from 8.2 to 5.7 degrees when the reel wears from 5 inches to 4.5 inches at a height of cut of 0.125 inches. Now, I should point out that on some of the newer units on the market, the bed knife angle remains constant as the reel diameter decreases. Here's a diagram showing a new 5-inch diameter reel on the left and a worn 4.7 inch diameter reel on the right. Now both units are set with a height of cut of 0.160 inches. The distance from the bottom of the bed knife blade on the left to the bench is 0.129 inches. But with the worn reel on the right, this distance changes to only 0.094 inches. Therefore, the bed knife angle is reduced, which decreases the mower aggressiveness with the worn reel. Furthermore, the potential to drag the bed knife along the ground increases with the worn reel, given that the clearance from the bottom of the knife to the ground decreases. The width of the bed knife will also influence the aggressiveness of the mower and the effective height of cut. An extended bed knife puts the mower in a less aggressive position. For example, here is an image showing a John Deere low-cut bed knife with the edge painted white, and the red bed knife underneath is the extended JRM knife, which changes the bind center distance, or BCD, by as much as 50%. So an extended knife may be useful when the greens are very soft or under significant stress, or maybe you're experiencing scalping, and the extended knife may help in this case. The number of blades on the reel will also influence the effective height of cut. A 14-blade reel versus an 11-blade reel should be expected to cut about 10 thousandths of an inch lower. And why is that? Well, for starters, the 14-blade reel is heavier. Each additional blade adds about 1¾ pound for a total of about 5 pounds added to the reel, so more down pressure. Additionally, the 14-blade reel may yield a faster clip frequency, and we will discuss the frequency of clip in more detail later in this presentation. The style of the front roller will also impact the effective height of cut. Grooved front rollers will generally mow lower and more aggressively than a smooth front roller. However, the weight also will influence the effective height of cut and must be considered. A heavy, smooth front roller may cut just as low as a lightweight grooved front roller. You may also consider segmented front rollers, especially where the mower must make sharp turns when mowing the perimeter pass on the greens, as this roller style reportedly will reduce wear and tear. Finally, on the topic of effective height of cut, the operator can raise the height of cut by placing additional weight on the mower handle, or vice versa, can lower the cut by pushing up on the handle. Additionally, the characteristics of the putting green will impact the effective height of cut. The same mower will effectively mow lower on this green profile shown in the left image due to significantly more thatch in the profile than on the right. So in summary, for effective height of cut, comparing the bench setting from one course to another has no real value. There are simply too many variables affecting the height of cut in the field. Now I'd like to move on to discuss the reel to bed knife contact. And I'd like to start by encouraging everyone to eliminate the nebulous terms light contact or no contact. Rather, it is really best to use the term clearance and define clearance with a known value. Now, most manufacturers suggest from 0.0005 to 0.002 inches of clearance between the bed knife and the reel blades. And as we reviewed from that Bernhard fuel study earlier in the presentation, the mower set up with 0.002 inch clearance used slightly less fuel than the mower set up with less clearance. When you're setting up clearance, use a feeler gauge, a paper or metal feeler gauge. And also, it's important to point out that 0.003 inches of clearance is likely no good and will tend to result in a poor quality of cut. Now, I realize the images of Mr. Hernandez from Bel Air Country Club are not new to those that are watching this webcast, but the take-home message here is to set up the mowers with some clearance, preferably based on the manufacturer's settings, and keep it consistent. Now let's move on to discuss the impact of an aggressive setup, and we'll define that here. So in this diagram, you can see the rear roller on the far left. You can see the bed knife and the bed knife angle or attitude in relation to the reel in the center and the front roller on the right. Now remember that the greater the angle or attitude of the bed knife, the more aggressive the setup. Additionally, the further the bed knife is placed behind the center point of the reel, the more aggressive the setup. So you might ask, what makes this more aggressive? Well, as the bed knife moves back from the center point of the reel and or is pitched at a greater angle in relation to the bench, the reel actually dips lower into the turf canopy. Therefore, it collects a greater amount of turf leaves for clipping with the bed knife. Now let's again review this illustration of a machine showing the bed knife angle at 6.2 degrees and the bed knife position behind the center point of the reel at 0.164 inches, the behind center distance or BCD. Now these values are important to help define how aggressively a mower is set up. And when the mower is set up more aggressively with a change in the bed bar in this instance, the angle of the bed knife changes to 9 degrees and the cutting point of the bed knife in relation to the center point of the reel, that behind center distance, changes to 0.279 inches. So in this case, this mower is set up significantly more aggressive than with that red bed bar. Now there are other methods to change the aggressiveness of the mowers. On the Toro machines, a shim can be added on the rear roller to increase the attitude and behind center distance of the bed knife. Now this image was sent to me by Jay Willis, superintendent at the Glen Eagle Golf Course outside of Memphis, Tennessee. And notice that Jay has both added a shim to the rear roller and is using the black bed bar, putting this mower in a very aggressive position. And after having the opportunity to walk and putt on these greens, I can say that without a doubt, they are some of the best greens I have ever had a chance to see. This illustration shows the impact of adding that shim to the rear roller. The bed knife angle with the red bed bar has increased from 6.2 degrees to 8.2 degrees, and the behind center distance has increased from 0.164 to 0.276 inches when that rear shim is added. This table offers a comparison of the aggressiveness of four mower manufacturers. The first column shows Toro, Jacobson, Baroness, and John Deere. And the second column shows the behind center distance when each mower is set at a height of cut of 0.125 inches and outfitted with the thinnest bed knife. Now the third column shows the bed knife attitude or angle in degrees. The Toro mower in this example is set up with the red bed bar with the micro cut knife. The Jacobson is outfitted with the championship knife. The Baroness is equipped with the standard bed bar with the 18G 1.5 bed knife. And the John Deere QA5 cutting unit is set up with the low cut bed knife. So from this table, you can see that the most aggressive mower with these setup characteristics is the Baroness model with a behind center distance of 0.393 inches and a bed knife angle of 9 degrees, while the least aggressive is the John Deere mower. So we've already demonstrated how to increase the aggressiveness of the Toro machines. The Jacobson unit can be set up more aggressively by switching to the tournament bed knife, which changes the behind center distance to 0.275 inches, and the bed knife attitude increases to 8.2 degrees. you're able to decrease the aggressiveness of the barrenness mower with an extended bed bar or an extended bed knife, which decreases the behind center distance to 0.295 inches rather than 0.393. And with the John Deere unit, you can change the aggressiveness slightly by adjusting the height of the front roller with notches that are labeled from 2 to 7, with 2 being the most aggressive. Now let's discuss why you might want to modify your mowers to increase their aggressiveness. Now first, a good argument can be made that the heavier fixed head mowers will help with proactive thatch management. For example, a floating head machine tends to ride on top of the thatch, while the fixed head machines will sit down into the thatch for cutting, given that they're heavier. Now, this may take a year or more to see the impact, and I really should say that this phenomenon has not been studied and is merely an opinion at this point. In discussions with several superintendents with whom I have a great deal of respect for, such as Rodney Lingle in Tennessee and Josh Cook down in Oklahoma, they have observed the benefits of the fixed head machines. Furthermore, in a discussion with Dr. Frank Rossi at Cornell, he revealed in his studies that the fixed head mower cut more grass than the floating head mower, even when the height of cut was set higher on that fixed head machine. Now moving on, the more aggressive a mower is set up, whether it's a fixed head or a floating head, will over time result in less escapes or stragglers or uncut leaves, however you want to call it. And a final note, when evaluating any modification to your mowers or when considering a new mower, the changes in surface quality are not going to happen overnight or with one or two mowings. It will often take 3 to 4 weeks of continuous mowing or even more to see the difference in the surface architecture of the greens. In discussions with some superintendents who have changed to a more aggressive mower setup, most all report that less sand is harvested from the greens following top dressing events. While I trust and value their opinion and observations, it's interesting that the research data and observations from several engineers says otherwise. And with that in mind, let's look at data generated from a 2013 mower study conducted at both Michigan State University and University of Tennessee. The title of the study is Effects of Behind Center Distance on Creeping Bentgrass Putting Greens, and this was published in the fall of 2015 in Crop, Forage, and Turfgrass Management. Research plots in this study were mowed 5 to 6 days per week with a Toro Greensmaster Flex 2100 cutting unit with 11 blade reels. Now the mowers were set up with a wide range of BCDs or behind center distance as shown here on the vertical axis. At the very top you can see that the bed knife was actually set up ahead of the center line of the reel, which yielded a negative BCD, and then all the way down to the bottom on the vertical axis with the most aggressive BCD of 0.386 inches. The control in this study had a BCD of 0.164 inches, which is the standard setup. Now the amount of sand harvested in grams is displayed on the horizontal axis. So if we study this, clearly the more aggressive the BCD, the more sand harvested in this study. However, despite the fact that the bench height of cut was adjusted to obtain the same effective height of cut in the field, so they used a prism gauge in this study to adjust the height of cut higher on the more aggressive BCDs to ideally get the same effective height of cut in the field. However, despite that, the most aggressive BCD yielded significantly more turf grass clippings than the other treatment. So This would indicate that the more aggressive BCD likely should have been set at a higher height of cut or bench setting, and as such, more than likely, this would have harvested less sand. So while I applaud this research, I feel that the research community needs to continue to look at this to draw any final conclusions. If we review our original question, whether a more aggressive setup will harvest more sand or less sand, I'm afraid the answer is not entirely clear. And consequently, I would encourage you to conduct your own study. Use just one mower and measure two equal areas on a putting green for mowing with that same mower with a non-aggressive and aggressive setup. Collect the clippings in each area and weigh the clippings and observe each area with a prism gauge. Adjust the bench setting or bench height of cut until the clipping yield matches in the two areas. And now apply a normal top dressing rate to the two areas, brush in, water that night, and the next day mow the two areas again and collect the clippings and weigh them to evaluate how much sand was picked up in the aggressive and non-aggressive setup mower. Now let's move on to a very hot topic in the industry, and that is the frequency of clip. So first, we'll define what the frequency of clip is, and then we'll move on to talk about whether the frequency of clip really matters at today's low mowing heights. The frequency of clip is the distance traveled between the shear points, and that is the point at which the rail blades pass over the bed knife, and that is shown here on the right illustration. On the left diagram, you can see that the frequency of clip can be calculated if you know the mowing speed in miles per hour, the number of blades on the reel, probably 11 or 14 or 15, and the speed at which the reel is turning in RPM or revolutions per minute. As an example of this, an operator walk mowing at 3.8 miles per hour with a 14 blade reel turning at 2200 RPMs would be cutting with a frequency of clip of 0.130 inches. By comparison, if the same unit was outfitted with, let's say, an 11 blade reel, the frequency of clip would be slower at 0.166 inches. So what is the ideal frequency of clip? Well, some industry experts contend that the frequency of clip should be equal to the bench height of cut. However, some feel that the faster frequency of clip, the better the quality of cut, and the faster the green speeds. So here is a joint study between Michigan State University and University of Tennessee with Tom Nicolai and John Sorokin. So they designed a study at three different mowing heights, from the lowest at 80 thousandths up to 140 thousandths. And at each of those mowing heights, they used three different frequency of clip rates, ranging from 0.1 up to 0.149. They used Toro Greensmaster Flex 2100 units in this study, each outfitted with 14 blade reels and the EdgeMax microcut bed knives. The data collected in this study include all of these factors shown here in this slide, but let's specifically look at the frequency of clip impact on green speed and clipping weight. There was no interaction on green speed. You can see that the height of cut at the top here resulted in faster green speeds with the 80 thousandths of an inch height of cut, yielding 16 inches faster green speed compared to the 140 height of cut, which makes sense. But down at the bottom, you can see that the frequency of clip at each bench setting had no impact on green speed. You might have expected the higher frequency of clip to harvest more clippings, but in this study, there was no interaction between frequency of clip and clipping yield. At least at the mowing heights and relatively small range of frequency of clip used in this study, there was no impact on the playability or the quality of the putting surface. But keep in mind that one study does not close the book on frequency of clip. For example, a superintendent here in Arizona who's a friend of mine demonstrated to me the effects of a very high frequency of clip using a Jacobson mower set with a frequency of clip of 0.069. And the clipping texture with this mower was much smaller. In other words, the cut leaf blades were much tinier and smaller when compared to a mower set up with a much slower frequency of clip. In fact, my five-year-old could have seen the difference in the clippings. So this topic really warrants further investigation, and we will delve a little bit further into this on the next few slides. During a trip over to Southern California to Bel Air Country Club last week with Brian Sullivan, we were able to evaluate the difference in clipping yield when changing the frequency of clip. So we used one mower only. We used a Toro Greensmaster E-Flex 2100 unit, and we mowed five passes of equal length and width using the backtrack method with a frequency of clip of 0.149 and 0.115. So the only variable change between the two mowing areas was the frequency of clip. And the results are shown here, and you can see that the faster frequency of clip at 0.115 yielded 71% more clippings than the same area mowed with a slower frequency of clip. And here's an image of the clippings harvested in the mower basket and the clippings being weighed. So although there were significant differences in clippings, in this case there was no distinguishable difference in the effective height of cut or the number of uncut leaf blades as observed through the prism gauge. However, remember that this was just one mowing event. When evaluated over 3 to 4 weeks or more than likely, I think you'll see a significant difference. On the new Toro models, the frequency of clip can be modified by changing the order of the pulleys shown in these photos here. And from left to right with the pulleys, the white, black, and red combination yields the fastest frequency of clip. On the Jacobson units, and that's shown in the upper right here, the frequency of clip can be changed even easier just with the push of a button. To sum up the frequency of clip discussion, a frequency of clip that is equal to the height of cut is considered ideal, but I would encourage you to challenge that notion and experiment with different frequency of clip rates at your facility. Of course, be mindful that some contend that a very fast frequency of clip will harm the turf, as the reels may potentially pass over the turf blades multiple times. Now, to my knowledge, this has not been confirmed, but it is certainly something to look out for. As we near the conclusion of this webcast, I would like to wrap up with a short discussion on mower scalping and the impact of double cutting. Mower scalping can occur either from the bed knife gouging the turf or dragging along the surface, as shown in this image, or the reel may be simply too low into the turf canopy. If the bed knife is gouging, there is not enough clearance between the bottom of the bed knife and the surface of the green. The goal should be to have at least a minimum 30 thousandths of an inch clearance from the bottom of the bed knife to the surface of the green. So for example, if the prism gauge reads 0.100 inches, a tenth of an inch, the bed knife should be no thicker than 0.070 inches, 70 thousandths of an inch, a clearance of 30 thousandths of an inch. At very low effective height of cut, such as only 80 thousandths of an inch as observed through the prism gauge, the bed knife should not be thicker than 50 thousandths of an inch, which means it must be ground down to achieve this value. Rodney Lingle sent me this image of a bed knife off of one of his green mowers that had been ground down to 40 thousandths of an inch to provide enough clearance from the surface of the green to avoid scalping. Check all the bed knives when they arrive at your shop and make sure the thickness is where you want and is consistent throughout the width of the bed knife. The final subject on double mowing is important. Experience at our USGA championships has clearly demonstrated the benefits of double mowing for green speed and for putting quality. Additionally, double mowing allows for double grooming or double brushing, which is proven to produce a more upright and denser putting surface. So how often can you double mow? Well, under healthy turf conditions and a good growing environment, double cutting can be performed every day without cause for concern. However, when growth slows due to weather or other factors, double mowing should not be conducted. This is an interesting slide. Tom Nicolai from Michigan State University sent this to me with his permission to share with all of you. So the question for you is, which of these three turf plots within these black rectangles is greener? So take a look and we'll talk about it on the next slide. So did you make your selection? Well, these three turf plots were mowed with three different mowers, all set at a bench setting of 0.120 inches. Now, one treatment was double cut using a perpendicular mowing pattern on a daily basis. Another treatment was double cut using the backtrack method on a daily basis. And finally, the last treatment was only single cut, and that mower was set with a frequency of clip at 0.110, while both of the double cut mowers were set with a slower frequency of clip of 0.148. So which plot is the greenest? Well, the rectangle closest to us in this image was the greenest, and this was the plot mowed using the backtrack method. The middle plot was single cut, and the plot furthest away was double cut using the perpendicular pattern. For reasons, honestly, that are not readily explainable, the backtrack method was greener and healthier than in the single cut areas or in the areas that were double cut using the perpendicular fashion. The lesson from this, well, it's a continuing theme throughout this webcast, and that is, don't be afraid to experiment with the mower setup, the mowing pattern, or double mowing at your facility, and allow for 3 to 4 weeks to properly evaluate the results. In conclusion, I really hope this webcast and the article titled Managing Mower Setup to Achieve Quality Putting Surfaces, published in the February 2016 Digital Green Section Record, raises awareness of the importance of mower setup if you are striving to achieve the highest quality putting surfaces. Whether you're low budget, high budget, daily fee, or private, everyone should place a high importance on mowing quality. Thank you so much for your time and attention.